This message is brought to you by Journey Life Church. Visit us today at journeylife.church or find us on Facebook. Welcome to the next episode of JLC's Superhero Talk. I'm your host and resident nerd, Tim Burton. Today we only have one superhero that we need to discuss, so I'm just going to jump right in so we don't waste any time. Today we're talking about the one, the only, the Hulk. The Hulk is known as Bruce Banner. Bruce Banner was a scientist that was doing experiments with gamma radiation when, you guessed it, something went terribly wrong. So, as this wave of gamma radiation pours over him, he becomes something very big, very mean, and very green. The Hulk. Whenever he gets angry, Bruce goes from pacifist to angry, I'm gonna smash everything I see, in next to no time whatsoever. In fact, depending on how angry he is, he goes from being 15 feet tall to 25 feet tall. That's a big, big problem. So needless to say, being polar opposites, they absolutely hated each other. I mean, they were just lashing out at each other the best that they could, sharing the same body. But I did catch them at one point in time writing on each other's Facebook walls. The Hulk wrote on Bruce's wall saying he was puny and weak, and that's just uncalled for. Anyways, Bruce gets tired of it and finds a way to make all parties happy, and he does what all of us wish we could do with all our problems and just splits them in two. Bruce goes one way, the Hulk goes the other, and they never see each other again. So there you have it, the Hulk in a nutshell. And that concludes this episode of JLC's Superhero.
The last few weeks we've been talking about superheroes. And the idea is kind of that there's a superhero inside of all of us with God, with the spirit of the living God living in us. And you know, Jesus said that you'll do greater things than I've done. He was talking to his disciples there, and it applies for all time, for all of his disciples, saying, you're going to do greater things than raising the dead back to life. You're going to do greater things than turning water into wine. Greater things than healing a man born blind or healing a cripple. So this power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in us. As Christ's followers, we are going to do or should be doing greater things than even Jesus did. That's what he said would happen. And so basically, this is superpower, right? Like to lay your hand on someone, pray for them, and they get healed, that's kind of super. It maybe isn't a power that the world would want or that people outside Christianity would even desire. And it's not something that comes from us. Right? All of the superheroes we've talked about have something inherent in them that makes them great and super. They may have taken a different road to get there, but there's no God kind of giving them superpowers. And while it might seem a little weird to think about things like healing and raising from the dead as superpowers, think about how it might seem to people that haven't grown up with us or that haven't been in church. Seems like magic, right? While we have perhaps different words for it, there is kind of this idea of a superhero in all of us. Now, I'll never forget this time. I went on a missions trip in San Francisco. And my friend Cliff, he was our leader there, and he posed this question. If you could have any superpower, what would it be? But he said, hold on, there's a catch. It can't be any of the normal superpowers. Can't choose to fly. Can't choose to mind read. I can't read your mind, right? It's kind of, okay. You can't choose any of the normal superpowers that everybody else has. So we had to think about it for a little bit. And Cliff had obviously thought about it previously, and he was quick. This was his superpower. He could sweat cologne. That was what he would choose, to sweat cologne. And at first you're like, that is weird, man. But then he explained it. He said there's three advantages to this. First, you never have to shower again. Like, you always smell good. And the harder you work out, the better you smell. You know? So that's incentive to get really buff. He's like, second, like, you never want for female companionship because you smell so good, right? Like, the girls would flock to a guy that was constantly smelling like, what, Calvin Klein, whatever that is. And then thirdly, he said, I could bottle it and sell it. And I could be rich off of the superpower of sweating cologne out. I was like, yeah. I mean, I can't argue with any of those things, really. It sounds great. Another girl, her superpower would have been she can drip coffee out of her nose. I don't really know where that came from, and I would not want to drink it. Her name was Coffee Snot Girl. Can you see that in the store, like selling snot coffee? That probably wouldn't go over too well. My super power that I came up with was really probably not much better. I decided it would be really cool if I could transform parts of my body, like a finger, a hand, an arm, or something, into some kind of food. And then once that food was consumed by someone, it would grow back. So it'd be like, I want a donut, pow! You know, a donut for a hand. And, you know, they eat it, then I got my hand back. Not sure that that's really super useful, but, you know, if you would be totally fine on food. You want the best steak you've ever had, I can make it for you. You know, that maybe it could be pretty useful. But I think that thinking about this kind of illustrates to us that there's something within all of us that wants to be great. Like, we want to do something that matters, right? I heard a quote that said, the point is not to live forever. The point is to create something that will. And that's this idea that as people, we kind of fall in love with the fact of being famous or known or maybe doing something that's never been done before. You know, I want to be the first guy to go to the moon. Oh, it's done already, dang it. You know, we have this innate desire, and that drives us as a people to be really cool, to do amazing things. That's, I think, deep down inside of us, God planted it there. That God planted it in us to make a difference in the world around us. And I think Dr. Bruce Banner was really no different. Like, as he's experimenting with gamma rays, he kind of wants to just do something awesome, right? It turns out that he what he did wasn't quite what he expected, but maybe the motivation behind it was that he wanted to be really cool. And in the process, he became one of the biggest, baddest, toughest superheroes ever, the Hulk. And I think, really, I identify with the Hulk a lot because of my huge muscles. I mean, take a look at these. I think I got a little sun yesterday hitting a golf ball. Like, you should have seen that thing flying. You know, I wanted to wear a little bit tighter of a shirt to show them off, you know, but I thought, no, just calm it down a little bit. I also thought about, you know, turning green in the middle of service, but that was, you know, too expensive, and there are people that'll do that for you. But I identify with the Hulk because, really, I'm not huge. And as someone who's not huge, you kind of always want to be, right? You want to be maybe stronger than what you are. And, you know, Dr. Bruce Banner, as Bruce Banner, is kind of puny. Not maybe quite as puny as my arms, but compared to the Hulk, certainly. But here's the thing. Bruce Banner and the Hulk, they existed in the same body, and they're really kind of like two people in one space coexisting together, and they highlight sort of different characteristics of Dr. Banner. His mild-mannered nature is Bruce Banner, very intelligent scientist kind of guy. Then the Hulk is this big, huge, angry dude that just wants to smash things. And I think there's something that we can learn from his story, because have you ever been in a spot where you just wanted to smash things? I've got something for you here. If you really want to smash things, I suggest that you get some Hulk gloves and smash stuff, because, you hear that? Right. You know, these things, you can hit stuff and it won't hurt you. I mean, at least not as hard as I can punch. It won't It won't hurt me through this stuff, and probably wouldn't hurt you either if I hit you too, you know? But it, smash things. Like sometimes you get into the point of your day or your week, and it's going just so that you want to smash something, right? You can't take out your frustration in any other way maybe but to break some bricks or put a hole in the wall. One of my friends has done that before. He got kind of angry and broke his hand punching a wall. And while I feel that sometimes that same anger kind of gets in me, I've never gone that far. But maybe you have. Maybe circumstances in your life are such that, man, it would just really be a good release to just smack a piece of concrete. You know, I don't understand doing that really, but maybe you're there. Maybe you've got a little bit of a Hulk inside of you that wants to come out from time to time. And you see, just like the Hulk, I think we've got this internal conflict. We've got these kind of sections of ourselves that want to do good and be a good person and not smash things. And then there's another side of us that, well, maybe we don't always want to smash something. That kind of gets angry within us. You know, one time, Stephanie and I went to see the Cleveland Orchestra, and we'd paid for these tickets and went down into Blossom with the pavilion and sat down there, and it was really great. She'd never been there before, and so we, in intermission, got up and walked around, viewed the whole arena, and when we got back, the orchestra had already started playing. They wouldn't let us back to our seats. I'm like, I paid for that seat down there. I don't want this seat back here. And I started getting angry. Like, the more I talked to the person, the more I wanted to smash, you know? It's just like, listen to me. Like, that is my rightful seat. And Stephanie's there, like, tugging my elbow, going like, it's okay. We're going to be, and I'm like, no! I want my seat back. We've got this internal conflict. I mean, it might not be as big as turning green and smashing a building, but I think we've all been there, right? Like, you've got this guy, or if you're a woman, this girl inside you that kind of wants to do the right thing, wants to be kind, wants to be more genuine and loving and things, and this other side of you that seems to be constantly fighting against that. And then sometimes you see some of those good qualities in another person, and I think that's kind of what makes us want to follow those people. You know, maybe we see a celebrity that goes off and does some great work in another country for humanitarian aid, and we say, that's cool. I really want to be more like that. And so then that person sort of takes on the epitome of who we want to be. And maybe another time they do something that's completely opposite that, and then we realize, wow, I got let down by that person. You know, we have a desire to do great things and to be great, and part of that is this part of us that wants to be a better person, that wants to be kind and loving and all of these things. And when we are striving to be that ideal person, if we're a Christ follower, we're really trying to be more like Christ. We're really looking to become more like our Savior. But there's still this other side of us that is in complete opposition to that. And, you know, it's this other side that wants to be angry, that wants to do perhaps what we know we shouldn't do, that the Bible labels as our sinful nature. And this isn't really a slight against humans in general or personally me or you. It's really the sinful nature wins so much, partially because we tend to feed it more. And then also it just is so powerful that on our own, we can't overcome it. And the Bible says this, without some help, we would be dead in our sins. And so we've got this conflict between our sinful nature and our nature that wants to be more like Jesus. And so often that sinful nature just wins. Day after day, I find myself just, you know, falling and being completely, you know, in battle turns, like hacked to pieces by my sinful nature. It's like the Hulk wins, right? In Bruce Banner, the Hulk wins. When he gets angry, he can't really do anything about it. The Hulk takes over and becomes a 25-foot-tall monster smashing things. And if you've ever been here too, where there is this conflict in your life, you're in great company. In Romans chapter 7, Paul talks about this conflict. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Romans chapter 7. We're going to start at about verse 14. And Paul really highlights this conflict that we see lived out in our own lives and that we see in Bruce Banner as well. In Romans 7, verse 14, he's talking about the law and our relationship to the law and sin and how these things play together. And he says, "So the trouble's not with the law, for it is spiritual and good. The trouble's with me, for I am all too human, a slave to sin. I don't really understand myself, for I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. But if I know that what I'm doing is wrong, this shows that I agree the law is good. So I'm not the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. That is my sinful nature." Verse 18, "And I know that nothing good lives in me. That is my sinful nature. I want to do what's right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway." It's the conflict, that internal conflict between doing right and doing wrong. And Paul here is a guy that wrote 13 books of the Bible, more than any other single author. And yet here he struggles and he says, "I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway." I think a lot of times we feel alone as Christians in our struggle, in this battle between doing right and doing wrong. We feel out on an island, but Paul is talking exactly about going through the things that we go through, this battle between right and wrong. And he indicates that he tries to do right but can't, that the sinful nature, the Hulk, wins every time. The things he don't want to do overtakes him. And I've felt that way many times before, and I think that we all have. So how is it that we can win this battle? How can we deal with this conflict with the sinful nature and doing good? How can we become Bruce Banner and let the Hulk go a separate way? How can we keep these two from fighting? Bruce Banner, I think he came to terms with who he was. That there was a part of him that was angry and mean and just a big, huge beast that would smash stuff to bits. And the other part, the part that he wanted to be, was puny, yes, but a better person. Not angry. Smart, intelligent, able to figure things out. Works well with people. And so he realized that understanding who he is, that this nature existed in him, was kind of the first step. Because you see, we are constantly going to be dealing with this conflict. The sinful nature doesn't take a day off and let us sort of just have a break from doing right or doing wrong. It's a daily struggle. Day in and day out, there's no relief from this battle between our sinful nature and what we want to do for good. But there is someone who can help. Let's look at what Paul says in verse 24 of the same chapter. "Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death?" Paul understands the Hulk is winning. Sin is winning. Who can save me? I can't do it myself. And then he says, "Thank God. The answer is Jesus Christ, our Lord." See, we need Jesus. Paul needed somebody else to do it for him, to be his savior, to rescue him from this sinful nature. Paul couldn't do it on his own, and if Paul couldn't do it and wrote 13 books of the Bible, chances are we can't do it either. That we also need Jesus to help us through this. And you know what? So did Bruce Banner. Dr. Banner needed somebody else as well. Let's take a look at this video.
"Hey, big guy. Sun's getting real low.
The Hulk needed Black Widow, Natasha, to help him control the beast within. And here's the thing, we need Jesus, but doesn't it get kind of hard sometimes to rely on somebody you can't see? When you're in the day-to-day struggle with your sinful nature, it's hard to say, I need Jesus, and to really be aware that he's there ready to help you, right? As humans, we kind of have this object permanence. As we grow older, we get the idea that when we can't see the ball's still there. But still, there's a part of us that when we can't see God, when we can't see Jesus right next to us, sometimes we forget that he's there. Sometimes it gets really tough for us to focus on him and allow him to take the battle for us and deal with our sinful nature, because it's not like we can walk up to him and say, hey, can you help me out here? I need some help. So you know what? Jesus didn't leave us alone. He knows that we as people need people. And he put us in places where we have a body, a family of other Christians who are going through the exact same stuff. People who can help. Dr. Banner and the Hulk needed Black Widow to come and do some weird thing on his big hand, you know? Maybe you need a friend where you can go and say, listen, I'm really having a hard time today. Can you just listen for a moment? Will you pray with me? Can you help me through this time? Maybe it's even much like, listen, I gotta go take a walk. Will you walk with me? We need Jesus, yes, but we also need each other. It's not a Lone Star kind of thing. We're not on our own here in this life trying to be a better Christian all by ourselves. We need each other alongside of this. Because then when there's somebody that we are accountable to, that helps us in our battle. That helps us because now we have someone who has got the same goal as us that we can grab a hold of and say, let's follow after Jesus together. Let's chase away the sinful nature and let's go after God together. If everyone would bow their heads, close their eyes. Here's our challenge for today, and in just a second, the band's gonna play this song again, but it would be easy for us to stand up here and say that you need someone else in your life to help you through the good times or the bad times. It'd be easy for us to say, go find someone that you can lean on. But as Christians, a lot of times it's about the other people. The people who need someone on whom they can lean. And so my challenge for you today is, how can you be a person that someone else can lean on? What can you do this week to be a person that someone else can lean on? To be that brother or sister in Christ that grabs a hold of a hand and says, come on, let's do this together. Now, I'm not talking about going to somebody and saying, look, your life's really messed up and I think I can help you, so let me take the reins and we're gonna, you know, I'll show you exactly what to do. the opportunities will come. God will bring you opportunities to affect someone's life for the better. But let's pray about recognizing them, having the courage to follow through when we see them, and that God would bring about an amazing outcome in both you and the other person. Because if there's one thing I've learned, it's that when you are serving and helping someone else, when you're meeting someone else's needs, your needs can be met as well. Together, when we grab a hold of each other and go after God, we're going to make it so much further than if we were trying on our own. So how can you this week be a person that someone else can lead?